That edition of Secret Society is among the programmes under review in Did You See on Saturday at 10:20. And in next week's programme, Duncan Campbell looks at the government's emergency laws and the contents of the draft Emergency Powers Bill for use in time of crisis. That's next Wednesday at 10:20.
It's more than 20 years since NATO planners decided that any future conflict could not be an all-or-nothing nuclear war over in a few hours. So the new NATO strategy has made the extensive use of civil resources vital to military mobilization. But Whitehall's opted not to discuss the implications. In secret, though, they've agreed dozens of plans for resources to be allocated to meet the US requirement.
Absolutely critical. There is no question, but it is one of the major wartime tasks of the United Kingdom is to be ready to receive massive amounts of material and personnel and to move them efficiently into the combat zone.
The U.S. Air Force itself, in official evacuation plans for U.S. bases in Britain, says,
"Here in England, we're in the front lines where the action is."
The last time Britain was in the front lines was September 1939.
This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note.
Shortly before war was declared, a secretly written Emergency Powers Act was suddenly produced by the government and rushed through Parliament. It gave the government authority to take over any resources it needed, conscript labour, and imprison people it regarded as dangerous. There was no time for Parliament to scrutinise the terms of the new laws.
That no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany.
A few months into the war, the new laws were found to be too severe, so Parliament quickly reduced the government's special powers. The new laws are only partly based on what happened last time.
Well, it seems as though a lot of the basic provisions are obviously similar and draw on experience from the Second World War. But in many cases, they seem to go a lot further and envisage much more sweeping powers for the government, particularly in a time of real crisis, of going far beyond powers that were taken in the 1940s.
Just as in the 40s, thousands of American troops would be coming to Britain, but much more quickly, needing more from us. 15 years ago, secret negotiations began on the Americans' requests.
Total commitment. In other words, for every plan we made to reinforce and resupply, there had to be host facilities to receive the material, transship it, secure it, protect it, so that it was expected that every host nation was going to meet all of those requirements fully and promptly.
That sort of requirement can't be met without new legal powers. So at the Home Office, special official committees on home defence have recently been supervising the preparation of the new war laws.
In the last 6 years or so, this government has embarked on a sort of major programme of rejigging the whole process and has produced a whole series of new bills with new powers and in different orders and so on, so that the whole system has been modernised and brought up to date.
On the 15th of October 1983, this senior civil servant was given a special assignment in the Home Office. Last year, Peter Harvey finished writing regulations to implement the new emergency laws. But Parliament isn't allowed to know. When MP Archie Kirkwood asked about Mr. Harvey's work, all the Home Secretary would say was that,
"I do not think it is helpful to discuss the contribution of individual officers."
So we checked the Home Office's internal directory, which MPs aren't allowed to have. Mr. Harvey's there as a legal consultant performing special duties with F6 Division. That division's only legal job is war emergency legislation. Number 10 have been equally reticent. The Prime Minister's refused to admit that any draft emergency laws existed, let alone newly written bills.
"It will be for the government and Parliament of the day to determine the content and introduction of any such measures. It is not a matter which Parliament need address now."
But why should the government want to conceal the new laws from MPs?
Well, I think they might be somewhat surprised at the degree of power that the government proposes to take, even quite early on in a crisis.
Widespread anti-nuclear protests have made war planning a sensitive subject round Whitehall. But we've talked to officials who've seen the new bills. They're already printed and could go to Parliament tomorrow. Today, they're stamped secret. There's going to be three bills, the first one to be passed very early in a crisis. It includes controls on public order, selective arrest and internment. Members of some army units have already been trained to run internment camps.
It did actually quite shock me to quite a large extent, because I'd never ever realised that was the type of thing that the TA was going to be used for.
One type of internment camp was to hold suspected saboteurs. An island on the south coast had quite another role.
This was a different type of internment camp. It was more for a mass of people, not for individuals.
What kind of British people were supposedly being picked up in this exercise?
Obviously, people such as pacifists, politicos, etc., were major targets. They were people that would be singled out for special treatment.
Were you under any doubt that this was a dry run for the internment of British civilians?
Absolutely no doubt about it at all. That's what shocked me about it.
A full list of designated essential service routes is posted outside your local authority headquarters.
The first two new emergency powers bills provide for controls on transport and movement by the public, at a time when many people could desperately be trying to move to areas they thought safer. The laws are intended to control not just panic, but dissent as well.
We're trying to get across to relatives in Lincolnshire.
Not this way, you're not. Essential services only this road. You'll have to find another route, I'm afraid.
Well, that's bloody ridiculous. You can't just stop people like that.
Essential service routes include major trunk roads through almost every British city. The name's recently changed, and now it's just effective traffic management. The government may not close roads completely, but police are still told to keep refugees off.
If that were you, I'd go home and sit tight. That's what they're advising people to do.
Fred's is fiction, but plans to keep motorways free for priority military operations are fact. Much of the urban population had been penned in and forced to stay put, with little hope of escape. One important escape route from the city of Glasgow leads north to the banks of Loch Lomond. But there's something about these famous banks that make this an area affected by yet another aspect of the secret new laws.
Loch Lomond side, on a fine spring morning.
It's a tourist high spot, but tourists don't expect to find what's hidden in the hills.
It came on without warning. I blend Douglas then, I tremble. Across the hills to reach Loch Long, and it put my mettle to the test, and in my heart a joyful song. But before my eyes the scene had changed. Man-made structures flank the hills, caverns grim of concrete grey, and rows so menacing and still. I wondered what these things could be, no reason for them could I find. A change of mood come over me that day upon.
Emergency powers, stage one. All the land you've seen would be designated as ground defence areas.
The whole areas around military bases, airfields and so on would almost be put under military control, in which they'd be able to clear areas in order to defend them. And these could extend for some miles around the bases, in which the people living in the area will effectively be under military control. If a house was in the way of a line of fire or something in defending the base, then it would be pulled down.
For the first time last year, the government admitted its plans for ground defence areas, GDAs. They would be
the area associated with the tactical plan for defending a base. Each vital installation has an individual GDA tailored to its needs and the local geography.
But who'll take charge in these special areas? In a crisis, boundaries between police and military responsibilities could get a little blurred. Should they be controlled by civil police or soldiers? If so, British or American? Officially, British laws and British police are in sole charge at all times. They should normally enforce the emergency laws. That's called the primacy of the police. But would this concept really work?
Obviously, the military are going to have sweeping powers to do more or less as they want to do, and that's going to be seen as the main priority. And peacetime legal constraints, I think, are probably going to take second place. Although the Americans are subject to British law, they're actually tried by American courts, so to some extent they are outside the British legal system.
This convoy is carrying British nuclear weapons. But during protests at the American nuclear store at Greenham Common, a ring of British troops and police were used to keep American forces and British protesters apart. But in a real crisis, would protesters be handled so gently?
I think it would be total resistance, a total demand on the British government that any interference be suppressed immediately and completely.
If there were such a resistance and the United Kingdom police could not cope?
I'm sure that they would call upon the U.S. forces to assist in the maintenance of order and security around our military bases and in our logistic support facilities.
I think if, in fact, that the protests got to the point of where there was actually insurrection or actual violence between the NATO military forces and the local population, then clearly American military commanders have the authority to use deadly force in the protection of their military assets.
I would have thought under these conditions something approaching martial law would have to take place, and the police are certainly not equipped for that.
How would the dispute as to the use of resources between US military requirements and British civilian requirements be resolved in this extreme crisis situation?
But the way they're always resolved, actually, I mean, the civilian requirements would come second. I think that's obviously...
Always?
Well, it did last time. I don't see why this should change.
The English lakes were one of the venues for a mock mobilization exercise 5 months ago. The exercise tested the emergency laws for the first time. Thousands of refugees fled from Liverpool to the lakes, tramping for miles in the hope of finding food and shelter in Cumbria. But with the Lakeland tourist industry closed down for winter, there wouldn't be food reserves to support hordes of unwelcome incomers, and that had caused public order problems, to say the least. Thousands of US troops poured into Manchester Airport and Liverpool docks. These became enemy targets and were heavily bombed. So the exercise anticipated that stage two of emergency powers had been reached. Civilian planes, like shipping and surface transport, would all be directed from a secret national coordination center. During the exercise, a special government regional emergency committee was set up in this government office block in Manchester. For 2 days in November, this was a mini White Hall ruling the whole of northwestern England. The exercise was only on paper, but there's nothing fictional about the scale of U.S. reinforcements.
Something in the order of 75,000 troops moving in the first few days of a combat situation in Europe.
And how many coming later?
As we mobilize the reserves, we're talking about another 400,000.
Well, I think if most of the British troops go to Europe as currently planned, there would actually be more American troops in Britain than British troops.
It would, we all assume, consist of American reinforcements moving in, certainly by air, clearly possibly by sea. It was the second thing, and one's got to assume a cataclysmic situation in Europe, would of course be Soviet counteraction. They're not going just to let these chaps roam around the place entirely unfettered and free. So we would quite literally be the meat in the sandwich.
In published information, the Home Office itself says that such military mobilization in Britain would cause
major disruption to the life of the country.
And this would lead to a situation of
shortages of essential commodities.
And
general national emergency.
Getting troops to Europe and bringing refugees and casualties back is vital to reinforcement plans. Dozens of holiday ferries will be commandeered. Like other NATO shipping, they'll come under the control of a new international NATO Defence Shipping Authority. So the second stage of emergency powers gives the government authority to take control of every kind of transport, roads, railways, air and seaports. Under a series of secret joint logistic plans, many of these resources are to be taken over on behalf of the Americans. The plans are part of a secret agreement with the United States. The agreement's called the US-UK Lines of Communication Arrangement, US-UK LOC in military jargon. It was signed in London in 1973. Britain agreed to provide the US armed forces with supplies and services, including fuel and food. The plans cover everything that the US military can't conveniently bring with them. What's needed will, under emergency powers, have to be handed over by the civilian community.
We were looking for everything that was necessary to receive the material, ports, warehouses, supply depots, magazines, airfields, and then the ability to identify the material, assemble it into shipments, and to move it on into the battle zone.
But the arrangement was secret from Parliament for 13 years, until disclosures 2 years ago. Then, for the first time, the 1986 Annual Defence White Paper gave details of the arrangement. It's part of a new NATO concept called host nation support. The list includes petrol and oil stockpiles, garages, parts and fuel, cars, buses and trucks. They're all part of what Britain has agreed to provide for US-UK Lines of Communication, or LOC. Rationing schemes will be introduced to control civilian use of food and important commodities. Petrol and oil wouldn't just be rationed. The plans reserve all supplies for government and military use. The plans also cover conscript labour. Thousands of people with many different skills would be needed.
You understand that it includes not only government support in the form of police and fire and border patrol and customs, etc., but it includes a wide variety of civilian support. The assumption is that the civilian population is going to be available and ready to support primarily a military operation.
These are some of the skills listed and required.
You may have a very good job in London working at the stock exchange what's the big department store? Harrods. And suddenly find yourself in a work battalion assigned to the docks or assigned to an airport as a cargo handler. There's going to be requisition of labor probably as early as reinforced alert and certainly uniformly applied in general alert or conditions of war.
The employment department's already made plans to identify those with the necessary skills. Kenneth Clark, Paymaster General, said,
as part of the arrangement, the United Kingdom has agreed to take steps to try to ensure that their requirements for civilian manpower support are met. Detailed planning and support of the arrangement is classified.
I can imagine the political consequence of detailing the planning considerations for requisitioning labor in time of war. It's not a requirement that many of us want to think about in peacetime and would not accept, I believe, peacefully or quietly.
Burton Wood U.S. Army Base near Warrington. Not just a warehouse, but the biggest warehouse in Britain, holding stocks to equip entire army divisions. Amongst the Burton Wood stockpile are two prefabricated 1,000-bed mobile hospitals for the U.S. Army. Inside acres of wooden crates are all the parts needed to assemble them. But to put the hospital kits together, Britain has to provide, according to official US information, 182 railroad cars, 28 trailers, and 490 skilled workers. It'll be local people who'll be told to do that work. The mobile hospitals are part of a bigger plan to make Britain a US medical base.
In fighting in a theater, and the United States specializes in fighting in somebody else's theater, the object is to keep our people there as long as we can, to restore their health if they're injured, and to restore them to the combat forces as quickly as possible. This generates a tremendous pressure on the host nations to provide hospital beds, to provide treatment facilities. In the United Kingdom, we were looking for thousands and tens of thousands of hospital beds so that we could treat people in the zone, in the European theater, and keep them there for the combat forces. As long as they're in the theater, as soon as they're well, restored to duty, as we say, they go into combat.
Stob Hill Hospital, Glasgow, part of the National Health Service. It's one of three hospitals in Scotland and about 30 in Britain, covered in the secret US-UK medical plans. The hospitals concerned are important to local emergency plans for civilian casualties. But the NHS emergency planner for this area has never been told what had happened. He just had rumours.
There is a certain amount of knowledge of that, yes. But it's in a very vague sort of position as far as we're concerned.
But Dr. Wilson hadn't even heard rumours that a second major hospital in his area was in the secret medical deal. Behind his back, the government also offered the United States the large Garth Naval General Hospital. Other hospitals would be provided by the Americans themselves. One of three such hospitals in Scotland is at Arbroath on the east coast. The US Navy will build its own 1,500-bed reserve hospital there. This old Gloucestershire airfield now accommodates one of a network of such US military reserve hospitals. Although they store millions of pounds worth of medical and surgical equipment, they're not to be used in peacetime by either British or American patients. And in a crisis, patients in civilian hospitals would just be sent home.
The effect on civilian hospital care is this: the big infirmaries would be basically dealing with military casualties and would not be dealing with civilian, ordinary type of illnesses that they're normally dealing with at present time.
All over the country, health service planners have been put in the same position. It's government policy not to tell them which of many large hospitals have been secretly earmarked to meet US requirements. But should healthcare planners not be told which of their hospitals are committed to US military casualties?
I suppose we would, yes. It would, to some extent, be helpful, yes.
This is how Health Minister Ray Whitney explained the medical aspects of the US-UK arrangement to MPs last year.
Plans will be incorporated in those for the National Health Service as a whole in time of crisis or war.
That's Whitehall speak for saying that the individual parts of the health service, its regional administrators, are not being told. So all the details of the US-UK lines of communication arrangement are still secret from Parliament, and even from those in government who need to know. The Secretary of State for Defence between 1974 and 1976, Roy Mason, told us that he was never informed about the agreement. His successor, Lord Mully, was aware that an arrangement had been made, but he wasn't told about plans to be based on it. That's all the more remarkable when it's noted that the parallel agreements with West Germany are public documents. This is the British-German host nation support agreement. The parallel US-German treaty reports exactly and publicly how nearly 93,000 German civilians will work in support of US forces. So outside Britain, the existence of host nation support plans has almost always been a matter of public record. Britain's almost unique in NATO in having kept its emergency laws secret. 14 out of 15 other NATO nations have debated such laws and put them on the statute book.
We're very worried that the government haven't disclosed plans for the next round of emergency legislation which they may introduce, because it is now that Parliament ought to be saying, well, is this really the best way of going about it? And it's now that we ought to be debating it, because during the Second World War, a lot of miscarriages of justice happen to a lot of innocent people. So it's now that Parliament needs to be looking at that legislation, deciding whether the safeguards are there, deciding whether it's necessary, or even if it should be tightened up.
The bills exist in draft form already, and under pressure of time and so on, that's what's likely to be introduced, and Parliament's going to be under pressure to pass these bills rapidly, and the amount of discussion is going to be very limited. And so in effect, what's being decided now inside Whitehall is what is almost certainly going to happen.
Do you think it's necessary to keep all aspects of war emergency legislation secret?
The answer, if you say all aspects, I mean, the answer is no, because manifestly a lot of them are not secret. On the whole, in a democracy, we ought, I think, to try and carry the people along with us.
Our democracies depend upon the willingness of the informed citizen to support the plans and objectives of the leadership. Now, if the plans and objectives are not ones that the citizens will support, they ought to have the information to assess the situation and reach that judgment intelligently.
Horse Guards Parade, London, is where one day this story might end. It's a magnet where tourists now happily gather by the score. But if we ever reached emergency power stage 3, there'd be a much more solemn and serious gathering here.
The final bill is passed, presumably just before a nuclear attack, which gives the government virtually powers to run the country as it sees fit, virtually winding up everything as we know it. There would be special courts with powers to try people and indeed sentence them to death.
Until a nuclear attack is judged imminent, civil servants are all supposed to be at their desks in Whitehall offices a few yards away. Then a chosen few would be telephoned and told, Operation Chanticleer has begun. They've then to pick up their papers and run here. A convoy of military buses and escorts will be ready to whisk them out of London. With a nucleus of cabinet ministers, they could be soon all that's left of national government if Britain is attacked. Then, with London emptying and in disarray, and the government itself buried under the English countryside, no one really expects that Parliament will meet to pass the third pre-nuclear attack bill. It had just become law by executive decree.
Come on, quick, get down!
For most of Britain, there'd be nowhere to hide from a nuclear attack.
In peacetime, people don't like to think about the ultimate demands of wartime. I'm sure that there's a conscious decision to avoid any public discussion of these implications of our war plans.
And just let's keep it secret.
Just not bring it up. We're not keeping a secret. We're just not disclosing it for public discussion.